everybody. Welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here, as always, with Luis Scott-Vargas. We've got more Rise of the Eldrazi spoilers for you.
Is that what that paper in your hand is?
Yes. I need the crib sheet again one more time.
Right.
So again, tell us, what are we talking about today?
Student of Warfare. Not a big fan of this one, and
really?
Not because it's not good.
you were so great on the new Figure of Destiny Dragon guy from last week, where it's like, what's wrong with Student of Warfare?
I'm going to like die to it a lot. It's a 1 white for a 1/1. You pay a white to level it up, and then that basically you spend 2 more white, and it becomes a 3/3 first strike. And eventually, once you've spent 7, it becomes a 4/4 double strike, but that's not going to happen quite as often. Mostly, I'm just looking at it as a 2-mana, as a 3/3 first strike that attacks on turn 2.
So far, out of level up mechanic, that is the most positive thing I've seen out of it. Being able to have a 3/3 first striker attacking on turn 2 potentially is really cool. Like, to me, having a 1-drop level up guy that does something has impact on the game almost immediately, and is still a quality creature.
Even later, 3-mana for a 3/3 first strike is decent. You can split it up. You know, you can pay 2-mana one turn, 1-mana the next turn, whatever. And the ability to level it up to a 4/4 double strike is not negligible. So, yeah, Student of Warfare is gonna definitely put the beat down on it. You can Ranger Vios for it. You know, makes Ranger Vios better in white weenie decks, and it was already pretty good there. So,
exciting. All right, moving on. Next one,
Wall of Omens.
Oh God, you're so good at this game.
Wall of Omens. Now this is one I like.
Everyone likes this card. Everyone's a big buzz on this card. I love it.
Well, it's just Wall of Blossoms, white 1/0/4 draw card.
I'm sorry, just like when pros and casual players alike are excited about a wall.
Everyone likes drawing a card, and I like blocking, so.
Oh, definitely. Like Thrynax, Bloodbraid.
Did I mention Student of Elements, and you can block it with Wall of Omens? So, I think Wall of Omens is definitely a good fit in a lot of the more controllish decks. And I can see it even being played in slightly aggressive decks, maybe in the sideboard or something. It's a powerful card. Wall of Blossom saw a lot of play when it was around.
I mean, it's no coincidence right now that you've already seen Perimeter Captains in the sideboards of a lot of the blue-white decks. If you're adding this card main deck or even in the sideboard, Perimeter Captain.
Yeah, this is probably main deck. Then you side in turn on Perimeter Captain, turn 2 Wall of Omens.
It's gonna make a lot of aggressive decks pretty unhappy.
Yeah, so Wall of Omens seems pretty sweet.
Yeah, enough said right there.
It's a good omen.
We all know what Wall of Blossoms does. Make it 1 white instead of 1 green. Everyone's still happy.
Yeah.
Where do we go from there?
We got Vengevine.
All right, we'll skip around. All right, Vengevine it is.
Well, Vengevine is the most exciting one, I think.
You really think so? I like this card a lot.
Green, 2/4/3 haste, and then if it's in your graveyard and you play 2 creatures, it comes back.
And what we were talking about at lunch, which I really like, is, we've both been playing a lot of the Naya deck recently, and when you draw that turn a billion D Birds of Paradise.
Yeah, now you've got reasons to hold Birds and Noble Hierarchs in your hand to hopefully get 2 to activate your Vengevines. But it also works great with Ranger Vios and Bloodbraid, even though I don't know if Naya can fit Ranger, Bloodbraid, and Vengevine. That's a lot of fours. It's possible, but I think having synergy with all those cards, with Ranger and Bloodbraid Elf, is a really good thing. It sucks that it costs 4 mana because they both cost 4 also, but there's a lot of decks that play Rangers and a lot of decks that play Bloodbraids, and Vengevine fits pretty well in those decks. Mm. I mean, accelerating out of turn 3 Vengevine, they're probably going to have to kill it. They can't just take 4 and then getting it back into play on turn 5 is pretty nice, or turn 4.
No, I think this card's going to see a lot of play. And the great part about it is it's not like a 2-of or a 1-of. I mean, you're going to want 4 of these guys in your deck.
Right. I mean, they get more powerful in multiples. You got 2 in your graveyard, and you just bash them.
Yeah, I like this guy a lot. I'm looking forward to playing with it. I mean, obviously, card advantage.
It also sets up interesting decisions. Like, if you've got a Vengevine in your graveyard, no creatures in play, and you draw, a Putrid Leech, I mean, do you play it right away, or do you slow roll it? Because you get way more value if you have get a Vengevine out of it. And if you've got 2 Vengevines, I think it seems almost definitely right to slow roll it. So it's interesting, those trade-offs, and that'll reward players who can identify what they need to do on the board, whether it's to play the guy right away or to hope to draw another guy. Yeah. So
great card all around. I'm really looking forward to playing with it and hopefully not losing to it too much.
Yeah, well, we'll see about that one since all right. Seems like a pretty good one.
From there, we've got Domestication.
Yeah,
which
I like
something
it.
You were more excited about than I was. But
well, okay, it's Control Magic, except at the end of turn, if the creature's power is 4, it goes away. Mm-hmm. But Control Magic was 2 good at 4 mana. And Threads of Disloyalty sees a lot of play at 3 mana. And Mind Control sees play at 4 mana. So, or 5 mana is what I meant. So having a thing at 4 which can take Sprouting Thrynax, it can't really take Putrid Leech because they'll just pump it. But it can take Sprouting Thrynax, take Bloodbraid Elf. It can take any small guy. Take one of the level up guys. You just don't level it up. It's worth thinking about, especially since 4 mana and 5 mana is a really big difference.
Well, you want to be casting your Baneslayers on turn 5 anyway.
Exactly.
Yeah, you don't have to make the decision.
Mind control used to be able to take Baneflayer, and that was a good thing, but Domestication can't do that. However, unlike Threads, you can actually cast it on a creature with power 4. It just goes away at the end of turn. So if you've got a way to sacrifice a creature or something.
Even if you just need the fog for the win or something, like to get around it.
So, I mean, it definitely has its uses. And any control magic, like Sower of Temptation, Threads of Disloyalty, Mind Control, all the control magics that I've seen, Vapor Snare, they've all seen play. So any new control magic, you definitely have to take a close look at.
So regardless of the, you know, stipulations they put on it, you still think this card is going to see some action?
Yeah, I think it will.
Oh, okay. I'm excited to see where that goes.
I mean, we'll see. At least until they reprint Treachery.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Right. M11, obviously, yeah. Right? It's not bad. It doesn't matter. That's a funny conversation. Yeah. Last on our list for today, we've got Dreamstone Hedron.
Yeah, the card which I'm sure that they know and love the fact that it's actually just three Mind Stones. Like, if you took Mind Stone and put it on top of a Mind Stone, put it on top of a Mind Stone, you'd get this. It costs 6, taps for 3, you pay 3 and tap it, you draw 3. So that's pretty cute, and that's the sort of thing that, you know, is kind of neat to figure out. I looked at it, and I'm like, hey, that's 3 Mind Stones. So the question is, do you want 3 Mind Stones in? Well, sometimes you do, especially when you want to cast an 11 drop.
So a couple questions that arise to me is, I mean, obviously the immediate playability of this card.
That rise to you?
Yeah. You get your pun every week.
See, I don't even have to say it. That's a pun. Even though I know you didn't mean it that way. Anyway, go ahead.
So, our 6 casting cost artifacts that produce 3 colorless mana, good in a standard environment right now. People are playing Everflowing Chalice.
Well, the fact that you can chalice for 1 on turn 2 to accelerate out of 4 drop, that's pretty important. I don't think you want to cash it into being locked into casting it on 3.
But I'm saying, do you want to be able to tiny chalice into a big Hearthstone?
But, yes, that being said, I've played plenty of 6 mana chalices, you know, and there's definitely a room for them, especially when they late game cycle to draw 3 cards. So I could see playing a couple of Dreamstone Hedrons in the blue-white, like Fireball Blue is what we've been calling it. Just, you know, 4 Marshal Coup, 4 Mindspring, all X spells. Because, when you want a lot of mana, that helps. And also if you're getting flooded because you have so many mana sources, it also helps. So it's not the kind of card that looks like it generally get played in Standard, but I think it actually will.
I mean, obviously, when I immediately looked at it, I was like, well, if you're trying to push out colorless spells, you're trying to push Eldrazi, this is a card that fits into that theme.
Well, yeah, it does a good job of accelerating out your huge spells and being able to cash in for cards if you're flooded, which is insanely important.
I mean, you've already resolved Kozilek.
When you're playing a deck with 32 mana sources or whatever, you want ways to mitigate flood because it's going to happen.
So I looked at this card and I was like, you know what? A post-shard standard environment, it might see a lot of play.
Really? Post-shards? Why do you specify that shards has to be gone? Is it anything to do with Blightning, Putrid Leech, Bloodbraid Elf?
So there are some faster cards in the standard environment that might slow it down. So looking at it, immediately thinking, okay, you know, if the standard environment slows down after Shard's Block leaves, maybe this will be a really good card. But again, trying to find room for it right now. And if Blue-White can play it, I think this is a great card to pick up early.
And I can see playing Block, too. I mean, in Block, there's going to be some sort of Everflowing Chalice, Eldrazi, All the Dust deck, I'm sure. And this is going to fit right in.
Yeah, this definitely seems like one of the cogs
of the machine.
Too
bad it's not Eldrazi, right?
That would be pretty...
Cast it with Eldrazi Temple? Yeah. That's probably not going to happen.
No. It's strangely...
I think they saw that one.
Yeah.
So, those are some pretty interesting cards. Again, it looks like this Eldrazi team is going to be really supported with cards like Wall of Omens, cards like Dreamstone Hedron. I mean, all that's building towards is a huge ramp deck. And then you've got cards like Student of Warfare, which are supposed to kind of take your fun away and kill you before you can do it.
Yeah, it's really nice that there's both sides of the spectrum. I mean, you could play the aggressive.
I guess it's nice that there's both sides of the spectrum.
Oh, you just want it to be one way or the other. All aggressive decks, all one season, or
no,
all
not all aggressive decks. It's okay. I realize the game is for more than just me. No, that would be nice.
Again, Student of Warfare and Wall of Omens in the same spoiler. I think it's great for the game. I mean, I don't think slowing down the game. I don't think 7 mana sorceries and 12 mana creatures is really all that exciting. But if it works, I mean, if we can fit it in while at the same time having level up creatures that do something, then it's all good.
Yeah, well, we'll see how it turns out when Rise comes out, which is not that far away now.
No, probably a couple weeks from when this finally makes it to the interwebs.
Yeah. All right, I guess we'll see you next time on that note.